It's very, very rare that people come together in these numbers with this kind of mindset. It really is quite an extraordinary experience.
I love the fact that this is not a club environment. It's so surreal. It's like not the place that you would party the way we party, and I think that really adds to it.
Bloc have got a history of supporting electronic music with heart and basically nurturing an audience that want innovation.
In 2007, two club promoters from Norfolk took the leap of faith and curated their own festival against the backdrop of an out-of-season holiday park that paved the way for the first Bloc Weekender. Nearly a decade later, this homegrown festival, known for its surprising lineups, surreal environment and hedonistic sense of humour, has garnered infamous recognition, but not always for the right reasons.
Shittest festival I've ever been in my life. It's so badly organised. Get the fuck out. Give me my money back.
At one time, when we were in Brighton, we did about a rave every weekend of one description or another, and we were either in London or in Norfolk or in Brighton, and you just build up all of this detritus. Mm. It's quite funny going back. I think that one day there'll be like a nice job making a scrapbook of all of this sort of stuff.
Hey, look, these are some posters from Deadbeat, which is, I would say, inspired Bloc. It was held at Pontins in Hemsby. Lots of electro, electronic stuff, techno. So when that festival ended, we booked out the same venue and did our version of that Weekender, really. That's some instructions for the first Bloc, I think, Bloc Weekend. Bloc will be a whole bunch of fun. We'd really like good people at Pontins had us back again. So please, whatever you do, do not tag or smash the place up.
It was good that the boys started that way because, you know, they kind of cut their teeth there and, you know, learned their trade or learned how to do things. It was kind of like a quite basic kind of 50s, 60s holiday camp that could almost be like an army barracks.
The chalets aren't quite as nice. The site isn't quite as big and nice. Slightly cheaper cousin of Butlins, you know what I mean?
Everybody seemed to get on board. All the artists embraced it. All the fans embraced it. The vibe in the whole place was just amazing.
In the grand scheme of things, all right, you know, it's like 2,000 people in a holiday park. It's not Glastonbury, but it was something that you could go around and tell people about. That was a really, really key point in the gradual, like, kind of snowballing momentum of the entire project.
After two sellout events at Pontins, Bloc had outgrown the venue, and increasing the capacity was high on the agenda. They took the next logical step by moving to the flagship Butlins in Minehead.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1, yo!
The through the night sort of format hadn't really been trialled there at all. So all of the very surreal, like, edges of the Butlins set up with all of, like, the arcades and the kids' stuff and, like, the fun fairs and the rest of it, because it takes on a slightly different character late at night, and we didn't know how that was going to play until everyone was there.
As it turns out, dancing until 10 a.m. in vacant bingo halls, surrounded by arcade machines, go-karts, swimming pools and chalet after-parties, went hand-in-hand with dance music culture, and Butlins became a natural habitat for the Bloc Weekender.
It's just like a mixture of, like, 50s nostalgia and retro-futurism and tackiness and insanity all in the one spot.
I mean, it is a kind of deeply noxious architectural combination of fast food joints and a bizarre teleportation back to the 70s somehow.
When they explained what Butlins was to me, I started laughing. But when I arrived, it was just much more intense than I could even imagine.
It's like an adult adventure playground, totally off the wall, in like the best way possible.
Pretty bored of partying in the normal places, you know, like Fabric, Berghain, whatever, you know, like a club environment. And I love the fact that this is not a club environment. I really love dancing on a carpet. It's a bit of a novelty, you know what I mean?
I often think about the staff, what they must make of it, because most of the year, obviously, they're dealing with, like, families and kids and all that kind of thing. And then for a, you know, a crazy weekend, it's just full of, you know, music fans.
To be a holiday camp for people that were bored. Now they turn it into a rave, a gigantic rave where people are dancing their head off for 5 days. Can you handle it? Can you?
I guess the ethos of the music at Bloc is forward-thinking electronic music. You know, certain years, at certain times, people are more into like more genre-specific stuff maybe. But I think these days, everybody's quite used to things being mixed up.
But they've always had this dichotomy between old-school hip-hop and old-school electro, and the kind of more carnival element and breaks in electro with like C-Fax, Astro Crew, and EDGMX, and IDM, exactly. What they'd call like brain dance.
I remember that before the first ever Bloc weekend, we're being a bit like, well, is this going to work? Like, you know, you've got all these kids that like this kind of thing and all these guys who like this kind of thing, and are they going to work together? But now, like 5 years later, it doesn't seem weird at all.
To come to a place like this where everybody really unites as human souls again, you know, and we share our passion and our energy and our great love for this music, and we move together physically and emotionally, that's a really, really special thing. And I think in these times it becomes more and more important to actually put down all our digital communication devices and just, you know, rave and sweat and really feel this joyous emotion together as one group of kindred spirits.
I've never been to a festival before more in my life that I would want to do psychedelics than this festival. Cause this shit's fucking nuts, man.
Your mix was excellent. Pretty intense, as you'd expect. OB, man.
So what have you come as?
Well, My Little Pony.
I think it's gone okay so far. Yeah.
So good.
We're happy. Yeah, yeah. Sorry, everybody's happy. Ecstatic, in fact.
Running it's easy, but
what's the hobby then?
Getting people to play at it.
12 hours. 12 hours. You said 12 hours, I do 12 hours.
What I want is a break in the middle so you can play the entirety of Rumours by Fleetwood Mac.
I play Fleetwood Mac after 6 hours.
So I got hired for the show, I'm doing my thing. I have like maybe about 4 or 5 girls. I put them up for the audience and they was dancing while I was DJing. I had them spanking my ass and shit like that and having fun, spanking some booty and shit.
Spank more ass! Spank more! Get some white bitches down here!
Seriously.
not want to believe you are sleeping.
Get the fuck out of my house.
It's the craziest thing that's happened in the last 2 days.
Where's the rider?
In the shell.
Hey,
that's fucking great. What stage is it?
Shitloads of people having a really big party, it wore Butlins down. They just didn't really feel as though it was going to work for them in its current form.
Maybe Butlins thought that the crowd were a bit too much to handle, or that they were getting a bit too carried away. I'm sure you understand.
They were dancing. They were dancing their asses off.
A 2012 at Butlins was not really on the table. And that was partly influenced by an offer we'd had elsewhere.
But I want to make sure that you know all about this Bloc 2012. You hear me up close and personal. Big Snoop Dogg on the Bloc in London. Let's get it.
The London Pleasure Gardens, a company set up to develop and operate a large piece of industrial land for outdoor events in London's Docklands. All they needed now was a flagship event to kickstart its reputation.
The guys had the lease, license, planning permission, and they were associated with the Shangri-La field at Glastonbury, and these were guys to be taken seriously. We left the guys to the preparation of the infrastructure, and we did what we do best, which was the programming of what we really hoped was going to be something on a sort of sonar level, but in London.
Every promoter has to like book people who are going to get tickets if you want to go to a certain scale. The reality is some type of artists don't want to go to Butlins.
Huge efforts were made to make Bloc 2012 a landmark celebration. Stubnitz, an ex-fishing vessel now transformed into a moving platform for the sonic and visual arts, set sail from Germany to become another stage at the London Pleasure Gardens. With the lineup announced and the festival build well underway, excitement started to grow for Bloc 2012.
Tickets started flying, started feeling really good. We didn't realise that there was quite a lot going on behind the scenes.
It was an old industrial site, so there was little pockets of asbestos in the actual sites, which we had to basically completely redo the whole site, to take everything up and put a whole new laying down. That cost increased drastically from what we initially thought it was going to be, probably by about 600 to 700% more. There was delays in money coming through, there was delays in money being released, there was delays in works, and so we had, I remember having a meeting, all the actual directors explaining that this one of the venues will not be delivered. It's impossible, and we were within the actual time frame.
Suddenly got a missing arena, and it's like your second stage, and it's not there. Eventually, it ended up being stripped back into something a lot harder to work with.
We always thought what we needed to do was to make it happen, and if we were to make it happen, then that would be, you know, incrementally better than it not happening at all.
I can't see with the door, yeah? Everybody, please stay calm, patient.
You need to stop letting people in the back because people are getting crushed over that.
I remember being backstage and looking at my watch and thinking, Snoop's half hour late, and I've gone up to the stage manager and I'm going, look, where's Snoop? And they're like, there's been an incident at the door, we can't say too much.
Organized. Get the fuck out, give me my money back.
Whoever organized this whole scenario needs to take a fucking
is to take a good look at themselves.
When a lot of the infrastructure that was on the site was repositioned when it wasn't delivered, it meant that it distorted the shape of the site and the way that it was intended on being used, and it created these pinch points. We took the decision to evacuate the site at about midnight on that Friday night. It could have been dangerous. If we stopped it then, it wouldn't have been dangerous and everybody was evacuated safely. There's no two ways about it. I feel chronically sorry that we had gone to go and put this party on. Those people had turned up and that had happened to them. And that is a source of horror for me, basically.
That was the hardest time in my career, if not my life. Yeah, no, without a doubt, yeah, that was a really tough period. But, and then it got worse.
With the first night being a complete disaster, the following night was cancelled.
If you do something which pisses off 20,000 people or something, then you're bound
they're
to
gonna have a go online, at you,
basically. Yeah. We deserved it.
Some of the things that people were saying online were ridiculous. Snoop Dogg got paid 560 grand. The boys have oversold 20,000 tickets and run off to the Bahamas, was driving Rolls Royces, six people had died. And he was like, look, man, none of that's true.
Both Bloc and London Pleasure Gardens went into administration shortly after the failed event. Bloc were advised not to make any public statement whilst an investigation was carried out.
We wanted it to be kind of something that happened, but not the only thing that defines the entire project. It was absolutely essential to what we'd spent pretty much our entire adulthood doing. If we let that be the final word on it, then that would really be, you know, be a betrayal of all of that hard work that we put into it.
Funny thing is, right, I could tell you which are the good ones and which are the bad ones, I could sort them out. Right, that was big, that was dead, that was massive. Era defining good one, wasn't it? Dead Silence.
That was a good one,
That was the fly, it's the fly that did it.
Oh, don't talk about that. That was a good one, that's a bad one.
After a gruelling year of legal discussions, Bloc were finally given a clean bill of health from the administrators to resume operating. A stroke of luck came about when a close friend of George and Alex offered them his lease on an empty warehouse.
It wasn't where we wanted to end up or where we had been, but it was real and it was something that could happen. The idea that you could actually have people having fun under a big Bloc banner, like again, that opened up a chink of light for the future.
I actually played the club they had in London. It was packed wall to wall and it's like, wow, this club is too small for Bloc.
I took to like taking screen grabs of Twitter where people said, I wish that Bloc would go back to Butlins, and just sending it to the resort director. All of the issues that you saw last time with a lot of people like kind of running and bouncing off the walls and all the rest of it, I think you'll find it's not like that. People are a bit older, people are growing up, and they decided that we were okay and we got a clean bit of health to go back. And we went back and we had one of the smoothest years that we'd ever had.
Channel 2, please.
This is the comeback show. Yeah, it feels like we're back home and we know how to do it here as well. We've been, it was the fourth one here, so we know how it works. Obviously, with the disappointment of London, it's really important for them just to show everyone, hey, we're back and we can do a really good show.
I have really huge respect to the whole crew of Bloc that they came back here. It's like a little republic, you know? When I think about Bloc, it's Minehead.
There's a lot more to like a festival that people love and the people who run it, a lot more to it, yeah. If it was just me and George standing like in a Butlins, that would be rubbish. All of the people who are here like kind of make it. So in effect, when it had gone, it wasn't just taken away from us, it was taken away from everyone else as well. So everybody's absolutely thrilled that they can get back. And it's theirs, really.
I love being there. I love being here again this year. And I hope they invite me back every year. Bloc is back, baby. I'ma bring this 808 to the Bloc. Gonna make them shock at the Bloc. Gonna make them rock at the Bloc. Gonna make them don't stop.
With the comeback year being a huge success, Bloc went on to do another event at Butlins in 2016. With possibly one of the most diverse lineups to date, featuring Tom York, Nina Kravitz, and retired snooker player Steve Davis. After nearly 10 years of hosting parties in holiday parks, Bloc had gained, lost, and regained the audience's faith in the festival. With spirits running high, one couple even made use of Butland's on-site chapel. After the many ups and downs of the festival over the past decade, and wanting to end on a high, Bloc announced this would be their last ever weekender at Butland's.
Two or three days after the final night of the final weekender, this think piece goes up in The Spectator, written by George Hull, who's one of Bloc's founders. Most of it was directed at the generation he described as dull hipsters, pretty much the generation of the entire audience of his festival.
I thought Alex was more the grumpy one, if I'm honest.
Really?
Yeah.
Having spent some time as being the internet's most hated sort of promoters, we kind of recovered it and it all went really well. And then in a very sort of classic Bloc style, one of us fucked it up again.
Yeah, sorry about that. He felt that raves had perhaps lost a sense of danger. He was essentially saying that I have no desire to throw festivals for this crowd anymore because all they're interested in is vegan meals and getting their homework done on time. We are past the age of the free party and the illegal rave. We definitely do now exist in a time where if a big party is going to be thrown, then it's going to happen in the form of a festival. So I think what made Bloc so important was it took the constraints of something being commercial and a business venture and actually put it in a setting that meant it still felt like it shouldn't have been happening. I think a lot of that's down to Butlins. I mean, if you throw a festival in Butlins, you sort of feel like you shouldn't be there the entire time.
They completely underestimated how badly it had gone down over the weekend. You had artists like Ben UFO being like, don't write a fucking article on a come down, you idiot. And people generally, this is what we talk about mob mentality, were ready to say, you guys have fucked it. If your first Bloc was 2016, you came away with this warmth feeling like we had at our first ones. Oh, it's such a great community at Butlins. And then the founder being like, you're nothing, kid.
Yeah.
Like, vegan food, fuck off.
The most insightful comment I read online was on Resident Advisor, which said, they always do this. It makes no sense at all. And I finished reading it, and I shook my head in agreement, and I said, you're absolutely right. We're always there and it didn't make any fucking sense at all.
I quite like the fact that Bloc has got its blitz and it's got an interesting history. If they were just squeaky clean, boring promoters, they wouldn't be very good rave promoters.
Never boring with them.